Hi, my name is Peter. I want to share with you something that I completely neglected, and that was a camera that I think is a super camera. When I shoot professionally, I obviously take a high-end camera like the Nikon D800, and it's rather large. I want to take it with me when I go out to a restaurant or to eat and stuff like that. Somehow, I have a very hard time getting this camera into my pocket. So what have I done? You've got little point-and-shoot cameras, right? I've got them, you've got them, but what if you want to kick it up a notch and you want interchangeable lenses? Well, I've been using this camera, and yes, I even bought it, and it's my own, and I'm even thinking of selling it to upgrade if they come up with a new model. That's how much I like it, and that is this little guy. This is the Olympus OMD EM5. Do I like this camera? I love this camera. Look at the size of it. This is a Panasonic 14mm 2.5 lens. And when I have this camera, it doesn't quite fit in the pocket, but it will fit in my pants pocket or a pouch. And because of the image stabilization, the 5-axis image stabilization built into the OM5, I can do what they call vlogging. Vlogging is when you talk to yourself into your own camera and you just kind of follow yourself around during the day or something to that effect. Now, the way I vlog is I take a camera and I take my thumb and my pinky and I put them together, and then that leaves three other fingers. So I kind of make a slot and I slide the camera in that slot and my fingers pinch the lens and the other three hold the camera. So the camera's pretty safe. So even if I trip, the camera is going to stay in my hands. So if I turn this camera on, I turn the camera on, and I can hold the camera out and vlog. Hey, my name is Peter. We're going to go for a walk. We're going to go to the grocery store. We're going to go to the bathroom. Oh, no, you don't want to go to the bathroom with me. What do you want to do? We're going to clean the kitchen, or we're going to go shopping. I'm going to show you what I bought, or I'm going to go out with my friends to a restaurant, and I'm going to show you my food. I can aim the camera. I can aim the camera down at the dog, which is sleeping right here. I can turn it anywhere I want. So that is one of the fun features of this camera. But because of the high quality of this camera, I use it professionally also. I use the Nikon D800, which I showed you. That's a D800E, the large camera. But I also use this camera. Now, in a professional sense, I can do two things with this camera. Either I can use it completely as the professional camera for a for a particular job, like a portrait shoot, or I can supplement. I use the Nikon, which, let me show you the size difference between these cameras. Look at that. It's a baby. It's a baby camera. And I've got to admit that this pancake lens that's on here makes all the difference in the world. I mean, it's so small. It makes, they have an EP5. Which has got the same 5-axis in it, and it doesn't have the hump on here, and it's a little bit smaller and a little more newer. I guess that makes it a touch more advanced. Of course, you've got the Panasonic GX7. Is it GX7 or DX7? I think it's GX7, which is their new little camera, and that's got a built-in finder like this one does, but the camera remains flat, and it's one generation newer than this, but still, it's hard to beat this camera, and that's why I own this camera. This camera's got 9 frames per second in the high-speed shooting, which is one of the reasons I bought this camera, because the Nikon D800 is only like, I think it's 4 or 5 frames per second, which is not fast enough in some of the situations I get myself into, or there's some signature shots that I designed for myself that I want to grab, and I need that high powered shooting. Now, if I'm going to take this camera and use it as a vlogging camera, I use it like this. But honestly, because of its size, it's a little bit too small. So it needs a little help in terms of the grabability. It always feels like it's going to slip out of my hands. But it doesn't. It does very well. Let's see. What do we got going on here? Oh, that's what I wanted to show you. You got this lens. But if I turn the camera off and I want to make it bigger, let's say I want to use this camera as a wedding supplement camera or I want to shoot a portrait shot, what I did was I purchased Olympus's two-part grip. It's got one part that's got the battery in it, and it's got an extra shutter, so when you turn the camera in portrait mode, it's got the shutter attachment, and it also has an extra shutter for when you're in landscape mode. It actually changes the feel of the entire camera. It makes it balanced and feel like a normal camera, but still really small. So I put those two pieces together. Then I take the little rubber piece out of the bottom. I'm looking at it. I'm supposed to be showing it to you. Duh. And it even has a place for it built right into the handle right here so that you don't lose the little rubber cap. See, now the pins are exposed on the bottom. And before, there was a rubber cap. So if you take the rubber cap out, where are you going to put it? Well, you're going to put it in the handle. It's got a handy-dandy little slot right there so you don't lose it. Now you take this, and I'll turn it around so that I can do the screwing on and placing it into position. Now I'm going to place it into position, and I'm going to screw this down. And now I'm basically putting the ability to have two batteries and have a grip. Now when I turn it on, the camera goes on and the shutter moves from here to here. They both will work, but when you grab this, naturally your finger's gonna go here. And now with this little ledge here, my hand fits in here beautifully and I'm able to shoot. Now, can you hear me shoot? That's one of the interesting things about this camera. It's very quiet. It's not embarrassing. So if I go to the front of a church or I'm in an area where sound is very critical, I can still get high quality pictures with this. Now, how do I do that? I turn the camera off and boom, high quality pictures. No, I'm just kidding. You take the lens off. Look, let me put my glasses on 1 second. Ever since I'm approaching my 50s now, so I don't see as well as I used to. So I push the button and take off this pancake lens. Now tell me, is that tiny? That's what makes this camera so awesome. It stays in a much smaller form. Plus, this being a 2.5, it allows a little more light than a 2.8. But remember, this is something that I need to talk to you about. I'm going to talk to you about it in a second. I'm going to take this lens off, and I'm going to take this high-priced lens, which is the Panasonic 12-35 straight f2.8 lens. And I'm going to put that on now. I have a 24-70 lens, 2.8, kind of like what you would have in Nikon or Canon. I have it here. And how is the quality on that? The quality is awesome. Now the camera feels very balanced. And for professional work, I have low light ability. I've got a built-in zoom. And the quality is as good as the zoom that is on my Nikon. But even so, the camera, I would say, is half the weight. And I'm shooting 24-70, and the quality is approaching this. No, it's not going to equal this, and it's not going to give me as many pixels. If you're going for that, then you need to go for the camera that you want to go for. But I can print professional results right with this camera better than I could do, let's say, 4 years ago with the cameras that I was using. This gives me better quality, and it's right here, and it's so small. So I've got these two lenses. But wait, there's more. What else did you buy, Peter? I bought a lens that takes me into a very high portrait capability. So we got the 12-35 Panasonic, and it's a stabilized lens, but this has got the image stabilization built into it. But if you didn't, this has it built into it, and what would you use this for? I'm talking in rhymes now, right? This has image stabilization, so you don't need it on this lens, but this lens has it. So what if you had a GH3? It doesn't have image stabilization built into it. So you can still have a 24-70 equivalent lens with image stabilization. Actually, the camera that is shooting this video is the Panasonic Lumix GH3. And what lens do I have on it? I have the 4/3, not micro 4/3, but the 4/3 14-35 f2 zoom. Now, I can't show it to you, it's on the camera, but that's what is filming this right now, filming as if I had film. Now, another lens that makes this camera amazing is this Leica-branded, Panasonic Leica-branded 25mm f1.4 lens, very light lens, but all of a sudden I have very low light capability. It's not a zoom, it's a 25 millimeter lens, but what does it become when it goes on a 4/3? A 4/3 has a 2x multiplier. So you're going to multiply two things. You're going to multiply the millimeter. So this is a 25 millimeter lens. So 25 times 2 is, come on, internet, 25 times 2 is 50. So this becomes the focal equivalent of a 50, not the compression equivalent of a 50. Now, those of you that know what I'm talking about, that is very important. Those of you that don't know what I'm talking about, I can't explain it too quickly, but I'll give it a shot. What it means is, you know when you get those very wide lenses and when you get close, your face becomes distorted and bellows out? Well, the longer the focal length, 50 millimeter, 85 millimeter, 100, 135, 180, the 200 millimeter lens, you know, the 70 to 200, the flatter the face. It compresses the face, and that makes it more flattering. So instead of a bigger nose, you get a flatter nose, and the features are more compressed, and it's a more flattering picture. That's why when you see professionals out there, and they're shooting with a big, long lens, and you're going like, why does he need that? I can shoot with my iPhone, or I could shoot with my little camera, and I can get pictures. Why? He's just trying to show off. No, he's trying to use, or she is trying to use, a longer millimeter lens because it compresses the image, giving you a flatter image. It's always better to use a higher millimeter. For instance, if you were going to do a big group shot and you had the room, you're not better off going to a wide angle. You do, and I do. You know why? Because we don't have the room. But if you had the room, you're better off with a longer lens. Now, to go and shoot portraits with this would be great, except you're getting the compression of a 25 millimeter, not a 50. So you just got to keep that in mind so that your images come out the way you want them to come out. So what I did is, for portrait shots, is I purchased, okay, before I take this off, this is my super high quality low light lens, f1.4. Now the 1.4 also gets doubled. So 14 and 14 is 28. So this becomes the equivalent of a 2.8 lens. Stop. I don't want you to get confused. Listen to the whole sentence, okay? Because this is a place that people really get confused. So I want to try to explain it really well. There's a depth of field. For instance, at 1.4, you might have an envelope of actual focus of that big. And at 2.8, you've got an envelope of focus that big. And at 5.6, you might have an envelope of focus that big. Okay? That's the envelope of focus. That is what doubles. The 1.4 becomes a 2.8 in your depth chart, but it's still letting in the light of a 1.4 lens. So you get the advantage of more light, and if you find this as an advantage, you get a little more depth of field. Now, I personally do find that as an advantage, because the advantage from between a 1.4 and a 2.8 and, let's say, 6 to 10 feet is a difference of like that much to that much. Now, the lens that's on there now is a 14 to 35, which makes it a 24 to 70 f2 zoom. It's a very expensive lens. Now, at f2, the depth of field is narrow. If I go like this, I'm just leaning back, my face is becoming out of focus. You notice I'm not as clear. The background is out of focus. Okay, but if I sit up and I'm in the right spot, boom, the focus just snaps right in. Now, if I lean forward, all of a sudden, I'm not in focus again. I can see myself on the little monitor over there. And when I come back in, it snaps back in. So there's a window or an envelope where I'm in focus, maybe that big. I can go like this and I can go like this, but the sweet spot is like that. Okay, so you've got to consider that when you're running micro four-third lenses. I know I'm getting too much of an explanation here. Now, why did I explain all that? Because Canon and Nikon have these $4,000 and $5,000 lenses, a 200 millimeter f2.0 lens. Why do photographers buy that? 200 millimeters at 2.0 for $3,000, $4,000, $5,000, $6,000. I don't remember what the price is, but the price is really, really high. But you get a high compression, and at f2, you get a very shallow depth of field. As a matter of fact, I've shot that lens, and f2 is too shallow because I can focus on the nose and the ear is out of focus. You think that's funny, and I'm laughing. But when it comes time to show the customer, they're going like, these are not so in focus, and it's a little bit embarrassing. So I'm taking the f2, and I usually shoot that lens at f2.8, f3.5, even f4, and still get that super blowout of the background, and which is so creamy and so beautiful, photographers go for that. Now, how do I do that on this, where everything is doubled except the light? If it's a 1.4 lens or a 2.8 lens or a 3.5 lens, whatever it is, that's the amount of light that's really going to go through. But everything else changes, your depth of field and the focal distance, the millimeters. All right, now, I purchased this lens because it gives me what the $3,000 to $4,000 to $5,000 lenses do. I purchased this 75 millimeter f1.8 lens. And this gives me almost the creaminess of that super expensive 200 millimeter f2 lens that you buy for your Canon or for your Nikon. Now, what did this lens do for this camera? 75 millimeter does what? It doubles. It becomes like the crop value of a 75 and 75 is 150 millimeter lens. So that's getting close to the 200. It's a little shy, but good enough. And it's a 1.8 lens, so my depth of field is double. Okay, I have a double depth of field, which would be what? 18 and 18 is 36. So it'd be the equivalent of a 3.5 lens of 150 millimeters. So what I have is all of a sudden in a very small, compact form, I'm getting images that is approaching, equaling or approaching, depending on how picky you are, what the $3,000, $4,000, $5,000 200 millimeters super expensive high quality lenses are on Canon and Nikon. Now, what's the quality of this lens? This is one of the sharpest lenses ever. There's no more to that sentence. This is one of the sharpest lenses ever. So I'm actually getting incredible quality in such a small package, and I can shoot and just shoot my, I need to turn the camera on. Just shoot my portrait sessions and boom. And again, very quiet. And I've got image stabilization. You know, the other lenses, they're not stabilized. The 70 to 200 is stabilized, but this is stabilized not because the lens is stabilized, but because the camera body is stabilized.